Well, students, in the previous two lectures, we have studied about three important processes which takes place when light falls on matter. The three processes were absorption, spontaneous emission, and stimulated emission. We also saw that only through stimulated emission, light can be amplified, laser can occur. Now, we'll be studying in this lecture today about a few definitions. First is what is meant by a metastable state. We'll be hearing this term again and again in this lecture, in this chapter. So what is meant by a metastable state? Metastable state is an excited state in which an atom can remain excited for a relatively longer duration of time, up to about 10 raised to minus 3 seconds. Please remember, we had mentioned earlier, in a normal excited state, atoms can remain excited for only about 10 raised to minus 8 seconds, very short time. But in a metastable state, atoms can remain excited for a time even up to 10 raised to 3 seconds. So, which is about 10 raised to 5 times more compared to a normal excited state. So, if we talk in terms of example, if in a normal excited state, atom can remain only for 1 second, in a metastable state, atom can remain in it excited for even up to 10 raised to 5 seconds, which is 1 lakh seconds. So you can see for how long extra an atom can remain excited in a metastable state. Next thing is what is meant by active medium and active centers. Now, any medium, we have talked about this material in which light is incident and different processes we talked. Now, any medium, any material, any system in which light amplification takes place, laser takes place, that medium is called as an active medium. Okay. Next, active centers. What are active centers? Now, out of all the, now in this active medium, in this material, there will be millions of atoms, but not all of these million atoms will take part in light amplification. So, out of these million atoms, only might be some thousand atoms actually take part in the light amplification. So, these thousand atoms which take part in the light amplification are called as active centers. So, if I talk in terms of actual practical laser, suppose we talk about a ruby laser. Now, ruby laser is a solid state laser. The active medium over there is a solid. It's a rod of ruby. Now, in ruby, there are three types of atoms in it. If you see the chemical composition of ruby, it is aluminium oxide, Al2O3, with certain amount of chromium impurity. So, there are three types of atoms, aluminium, oxygen and chromium. Now, out of all these three atoms, it is only the chromium atoms which actually take part in the light amplification. We'll be studying this later on in more details. So, in the ruby laser, aluminium, oxygen and chromium, there are three types of atoms, but it is only chromium which takes part in light amplification. So, chromium atoms are the active centers in ruby laser. Entire ruby rod is the active medium, but the chromium atoms in this ruby rod are the active centers. So, now, next important thing in this chapter, a very important thing in this chapter is what is called as the Einstein's theory of stimulated emission, in which we will be obtaining two conditions necessary for light amplification. Now, out of the three processes, that is absorption, spontaneous emission and stimulated emission, which takes place when light is incident on the material, these three processes can take place simultaneously. You cannot stop one process and make only the other process to take place. All the three processes take place simultaneously. But then, if light is to be amplified, it can happen only through stimulated emission. So, out of the three processes which are occurring, we must somehow make stimulated emissions to occur in larger numbers. So, stimulated emissions must occur in more numbers compared to absorptions or spontaneous emissions. Only then we can amplify light. So, now, what we'll be doing in this two equations, equation 1 and 2, what is basically done in this equation is, we are comparing number of stimulated emissions with number of spontaneous emissions, and in equation 2, we are comparing stimulated emissions to number of absorptions. Remember, for laser, stimulated emissions should be more than spontaneous emissions. Also, stimulated emissions should be more than absorptions. So, stimulated emissions should be more than both the other processes, absorptions and spontaneous emissions. So, in equation 1, number of stimulated emissions upon number of spontaneous emissions, we can put the values of NST and NSP which we had written earlier. So, we get it as B21N2Q delta T upon A21N2 delta T. So N2 N2 cancels out, delta T also cancels out, and we get it as B21 upon A21 into Q. Now, if you look at this equation, we want, for light amplification, we require that NST, number of stimulated emissions, should be more than number of spontaneous emissions. Now, this ratio will be large, in other words, NST will be greater than NSP, if this Q over here is large, because B21 and A21 are constants. We cannot vary them. They are fixed. So only thing we can vary in this equation is Q, the incident photon density. So if you want this upon this to be large number, NST should be larger than NSP, then Q should be a large number. So in other words, for light amplification to take place, the first condition required is that the incident photon density Q should be a very large number. Now, similarly, the second equation, we are comparing number of stimulated emissions with number of absorptions. Again over here, NST should be larger than NAB if you want light to be amplified. Stimulated emissions should be more in number. Now, putting the values of NST and NAB in this equation, we get this thing. So, delta T cancels out, Q also cancels out, and B21 and B12 also cancel out because they are both equal to each other. Now, why are they equal? Because B12 and B21, if you remember, B12 comes in which process? It comes in the process of absorption, wherein the atom is forced to go from level 1 to level 2, whereas B21 comes in the process of stimulated emissions, wherein the atom is forced to come down from level 2 to level 1. Now, both these are forced processes. Absorption and stimulated emission, both are forced processes, and both are occurring between the same two energy levels, E1 and E2. Therefore, the probabilities of both these forced processes are same. So that is why B12 and B21 are equal to each other. So therefore, they also cancel out from this equation. And the only thing which remains over here is therefore N2 by N1. Now, if you want NST to be more than NAB, which is required for laser, stimulated emission should be more than absorptions, then this will happen only when N2 is greater than N1. In other words, number of atoms in the upper level, E2 are more than the number of atoms in the lower level. So, if you want light to be amplified, then this condition must be satisfied. Number of atoms here must be more than number of atoms in E1. So, that is what the second equation tells us. If you want stimulated emissions to be more than absorptions, which is required for light amplification, then you must have N2 greater than N1. Okay? So, these are the two equations, two conditions necessary for light amplification. First condition is what? It is Q should be large. So, incident photon density should be large. And second condition, which ensures that NST is greater than NAB, requires that N2 is greater than N1. So, N2 greater than N1. There are more atoms in the upper level than in the lower level E1. So, these are the two necessary conditions required for light amplification. Now, the second condition, N2 greater than N1, is given a special name. This condition is called as population inversion. Okay, it's a very important term. It is a very important condition required for laser. So, we'll be discussing more about this population inversion in details in the next lecture. Thank you.